I'm going to do prayer first. That. Time to get started, fellas. Good to see everybody here this morning. Got a pretty good crowd. Let's all go to our Heavenly Father in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the beautiful day you've given us to enjoy. We thank you, Father, for the privilege that we have to be here this morning. Father, help us always to count it a privilege and not be, help us to count it a privilege, Father. We ask your blessings upon our sick, those who are unable to be with us this morning. We pray for them, Father, that sickness might be removed, that they may be back, restored back to their health, Father, and be back with us once again. Father, we are so thankful for the rain we received yesterday and pray that it would help the crops and gardens, people's gardens, and the things that it was needful for. Father, we pray that you would be with Mark this morning as he breaks the bread of life to us. We pray that you would help him to have a good recollection of the things that he studied. And we're so thankful to have him and Stephanie with us, Father, and for the job that they are doing. Father, help us to listen attentively to the things that are said this morning, but not just hearers of the word, but be doers of the word as well. Go with us throughout this service, Father. Help us to apply those things we learned to our lives and bless us each day. Help us to do your will. Forgive us when we fall short. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. I have a few announcements before we get started this morning. If you're visiting with us, welcome to the Tanner Church of Christ. If you'd like to fill out an attendance card so we can have a record of your attendance, you can leave that card in the collection plate in the back, or you can just leave it in the pew after you're done filling it out. Just a note of sick that we have in this congregation. Wayne's dad, Bill Bryant, he fractured his pelvis and he was to have surgery, but they decided against it. He's currently in rehab across from the hospital in room 103. Paulette Carter is in Athens Hospital and she had a UTI and now she's septic and she's in room 206. They moved her to a different room, so now she's in room 206. Rick Chandler has been sick. He's had chills with a fever, and we're just praying for him to get better. Among the sick, we also have Paul and Patsy Appleton. They have not been feeling well lately, and Patsy had injections for her back on Friday. Prayers will help relieve her pain. Also pray for Christy Golden. She's not been feeling well in the last few weeks. Other announcements. There will be a baby shower for Ashley and Bobby Ray on Sunday, July 16th. If you'll look in the bulletin, we'll have more details in there. A day of prayer and giving for children. As we join the other churches of Christ across our nation, we pray for the children of the world and give help to the children at Potter's Children's Home. This is a special day of prayer and giving will be July 30th. Make the checks out. If you would like to make a contribution, you'd like to make your checks out to the Tanner Church and put Potter's Children's Home in the memo of your check. If giving cash, please put it in an envelope and indicate what it's for on the envelope. I'd like to say thank you to all those who contributed to the EEM Bible Drive. We gave $2,780 total. At $5 a Bible, just think of all the Bibles and the amount that you provided. Also, congratulations to those that have said their memory verses. James Utlout, Colton Adams, Scout Jackson, Haven, and happy to have a couple of visitors in the Children's Bible Hour. As we start our service this morning, the order of service, Scott Sandberg will have the communion. Speaker will be Mark, and Daniel will have our singing. Tony Anderson will have our closing prayer. At this time, we'll let Daniel handle the singing service.
Good morning. First song this morning is number 100. Number 100. Come thou, almighty King, help us thy name to sing. Help us to praise, Father, all glorious, o'er all victorious. Come and reign over us, Ancient of Days. Come thou, incarnate Word, gird on thy mighty sword. Our prayer attend, come and thy people bless, and give thy word success. Spirit of holiness on us descend. O Lord our God, to thee the highest praises be, hence evermore thy sovereign majesty may we in glory see, and to eternity love and adore. In preparation for our Lord's Supper observance, number 764, we'll sing the verses 1, 2, and 3, and then the chorus only after verse 3.
When we meet in sweet communion, where the feast divine is spread, hearts are brought in closer union, while partaking of the bread. God so loved, what wondrous measure, loved and gave the best of him, bought us with that matchless treasure, yea, for us his life was given. Feast divine all else surpassing, precious blood for you and me. While we sup, Christ gently whispers, do this in my memory. Precious feast, all else worlds surpassing. Wondrous love for you and me. While we feast, Christ gently whispers, do this in my memory.
In preparation for the Lord's Supper, does everyone have a communion cup? If not, one will be brought to you. Also, I'm told that some of the communion cups, some of the bottom bread pieces are missing. They have fallen open, so make sure that if you have a cup, you also have a bread. Let us take our minds back to that cross. My Father in heaven, we're thankful for all thy wonderful blessings in this life. We're especially thankful for your Son, Jesus. Father, at this time as we recognize and memorialize his death upon that cruel cross at Calvary, Father, may we do so in a manner pleasing to thee. Father, as we pray for this bread, may we partake of it in a manner that is well pleasing to thee. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Father, we continue our thanksgiving for this cup and fruit of the vine, which represents Christ's blood that was shed on the cruel cross of Calvary. Father, we pray and we're thankful for all that you have done for us. And we pray, Father, that as you shed this blood, Father, that we're grateful for that, that we will take this cup in a manner that is well-pleasing to thee. It is in Christ's name I pray. Amen. Apart from our worship service today, it is the first day of the week that we are commanded to give. Pray with me as we do so. Father, we're thankful for all thy wonderful blessings. We're thankful for this time that we have to give as we have purposed to do so, Father, to further your word and further your spreading of the gospel on this earth and to do your work. Father, we're thankful for our jobs and our abilities to make a living and also to have those material things, Father, but we know that everything comes from you. Father, at this time as we give back a portion of thee, may we be cheerful givers, Father, and give from our hearts. Watch over us, God, guard and direct us, Almighty God. In Christ's name we pray, amen.
Thank you, Scott. Good morning. Good to see everybody this morning. My name is Mark Little, and it's good to be able to be here. I'm joking, of course. We've been gone for about a week and a half. We were actually gone a week on vacation and got back, and I had a speaking engagement, so we missed two Wednesdays in a row, so it seems like it's been a really long time. I'm going to turn that down just a hair. But it's good to be able to be back. It's good to be missed as well, and I appreciate that. I appreciate those of you who said that you missed us anyway. I don't know if you really did, but anyway, you made us feel good about being back. I hope everybody is geared up to have a good vacation or a good holiday, a good safe holiday, okay? Make sure that, well, we've already been reading stuff about fireworks, how dangerous they are, and we've known occasions, of course, in the past where kids have gotten hurt and adults as well, and so make sure that you're safe in whatever you do and enjoy this. I do want to say thank you to Richard and also to Henry for teaching and preaching in my absence. They did a great job, and I know that because I went online and listened to it. And I appreciate that. It's good to have men here that are capable and willing to do that. And when you, it's kind of a bad thing, though, because sometimes they might not want you back. No amens there? Okay. Amen. Thank you, Tony. I can always rely on you. I appreciate that. I had a guy come in this past week, as sometimes I do, from the community, and he just wanted to talk. And sometimes people have things on their mind they just want to share, and they don't necessarily want any advice. And that's a good thing, because I don't always have the best advice in the world. I try, but sometimes people just want to share what's on their mind and kind of unload and also ask for prayers. And so this guy was needing that. And so he came in and began to talk to me about his frustration about dealing with people in the community, the neighborhood that he lives in, and also the place where he works, and he's a construction worker. And he's just talking about how people have not been kind and friendly to him lately. And he said that he is a Christian. I could tell that really right away. Sometimes that just comes shining through. And anyway, and he says, I think that's part of the reason why is because I am a Christian. And so maybe they're giving him a difficult time because of that. But for whatever reason, he was struggling. And I knew that he was a Christian after talking to him for a little bit. And I asked him about church. I asked him about whether or not he had a church family, a church home that he went to, that he was involved in and that he belonged to. And he said, yeah, I do. And then he stopped and said, well, not really. I mean, I've gone over here and for a little while, went over here for a little while. And he began to talk about some of the problems. And I told him I was trying to get him to understand the importance of a church, of a congregation of the Lord's church. And that the New Testament is written to, inspired by the Holy Spirit, to different congregations that is governed and being shepherded by an eldership. And they are a body, as Paul talks about in 1 Corinthians 12 and Romans chapter 12 as well. And so it has all of these different functioning parts. Ephesians 4 talks about that as well. And so that it is actually from the very beginning, in its birth, in its infancy, is supposed to be congregations in different places that are governed by that and shepherded by that eldership, and where people can be involved and work together and also get assistance and help and encouragement as well. It is a Christian family. Ephesians chapter 3 actually describes it in that way. And so I was talking to him a little bit about that, and he said, yeah, I understand that. Maybe I need to do better at that. And he said, but I went over here for a while, and Mark, he said, it's almost like they were just coming just to be coming, to punch a time clock. He said, nobody ever said anything to me. I went over there for X amount of time. Nobody ever said anything to me. They hit the door running. And so that's why I left there. I said, yeah, that's a shame. You know, it is, isn't it? So he went to another congregation. He said, well, I went there for a time, and then at that congregation, I was actually being mistreated by some. And then he made this statement that just really, really made me think. He said, you know, I expected in the world. He was talking about all these problems, you know, at his workplace, in his neighborhood. And he said, I expected in the world because they don't have Christ. I don't expect it in the church. I didn't hardly know what to say. I told him, I said, well, the church is made up of imperfect people. You know, and if you're looking for a perfect congregation, when you find it, guess what? It's not going to be perfect once you get there, right? There's no such thing as a perfect congregation. But with that being said, we also are to be different than the rest of the world, are we not? We are to be different than the rest of the world, and people should feel a love and a generosity, a kindness, comfort, encouragement, and just a family atmosphere when they come to a congregation. That is John 13, 34, and 35. That's what draws people to Jesus Christ. And so my lesson has absolutely nothing to do with that. I wanted you to know that this morning. May we strive to be what we're talking about, what the Lord would have us to be, a family, genuine, sincere, authentic children of God, you know, making a difference in our community, loving people, being kind to people, being helpful, being generous, being salt and light, as Jesus Christ said. Amen. May we strive to be that. We're going to talk about freedom today because that's what's on everybody's mind, and it's a short sermon. I just jinxed it. Every time I say that, it's long. It's short, though. But we're going to sing some. Daniel's going to get up here. Doesn't Daniel do an awesome job? Amen. Does a great job. We appreciate that. So we're going to incorporate some singing in with our service. We're going to think about freedom today. You know, our founding fathers going back. You know, I've said this before, but I feel like I need to say it often because a lot of times our holidays are nothing more than a vacation. It's time off of work. It's downtime. We grill out, get together with family, friends, have a good time. And we have the freedom to be able to do that, right? That's one reason that one thing that freedom allows us, but we need to think about why we have these holidays. and why we have the freedom that we have. Thinking, going back in time, thinking about our founding fathers and this dream that they had to be free, of having equality, of having human rights, of not being under someone's fist, of not being inferior to someone else, that all men are created equal and having that freedom. Where did that come from? Well, you even see it in the Declaration of Independence, as I quote, it says, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, and that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, and that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." Notice they're endowed by their Creator. Endowed, that means given. And so that is a right that is given by God Almighty, that we have freedom, that we have liberty, that we are not to rule over anybody, nor should anybody rule over us. That there should be equality, that we shouldn't look down our nose at other people and think that anybody is beneath us. And so I want to begin this morning by looking at some passages that speak to that, to the equality and human rights. And I'm just going to, you've got the passages up there, so I'm just going to read one right after the other. "There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek, for the same Lord is Lord of all, bestowing His riches on all who call on Him. The rich and the poor meet together. The Lord is the maker of them all. My brothers, show no partiality as you hold the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. For if a man wearing a gold ring and fine clothing comes into your assembly, and a poor man in shabby clothing also comes in, and you say, 'Pay attention to the one who wears the fine clothing,' and say, 'Well, you sit here in a good place,' while you say to the poor man, 'You stand over there,' or 'You sit down here at my feet,' have you not been then made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Masters, do the same and stop your threatening, knowing that He who is both their master and yours is in heaven, and there is no partiality with Him. Finally, all of you have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and an humble mind. Here there is not Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, free, but Christ is all and in all, endowed by your Creator with certain inalienable rights." That we have the freedom, that we have human equality, something from the very, very beginning. Aren't we blessed to have that? Aren't we blessed to live in a nation that has that and bestows that upon us? And we talk about our nation in a bad way, in a negative way, so very often because of the direction that we're going. But listen, this is still the greatest nation in the world. I believe that with all my heart. There's still people that are trying to come here from all over the place because this is, the American dream is still alive. This is still the greatest nation in the world. And one reason why, and I would say the main reason why, is because our founding fathers realized that these things that we're talking about, this equal rights and equality and freedom, liberty, all of these different things are something that has been given to us by our Creator. It's not something that we're supposed to have to work for, but something that we are given by our Creator. But of course, over the years, we've had a lot of people try to take that away, and that's just human nature. And the more power you give a government, well, the more corruption and the more money and things of that nature, you know, it corrupts. And so people have tried to take over. We've been in many different wars over the years. And so we've had, even though this has been bestowed by our Creator, there's been a lot of brave men and women who have fought so that we can have the freedom that we have today. Amen? Let's look at this quote from the second president of the United States, John Adams, also a signer of the Declaration of Independence. He says, "Whether we live or die, sink or swim, succeed or fail, I stand behind this Declaration of Independence. And if God wills it, I am ready to die in order that this country might experience freedom. Man, that, I don't know how that touches you, but it touches me, because if you know it, I love American history and I love church history. If you know anything about these guys and know anything about him, you'll know that he was a very wealthy man, a very prosperous man. And so he gave up all of these different things. He said, I'm willing to give up absolutely everything so that we can have freedom. That is patriotism, amen? Man, we need more of that. We need more of that. Steph and I, the whole way up here, we're talking about this kind of thing and about how with each generation it seems to be less and less patriotism, but I don't think that's necessarily the case, because like in the 70s, I think coming out of Vietnam War, dealing with all of that, and you had a very, very poor economy, and I think the spirits, you know, of everything that I've read, I was born in the 70s, everything that I've read, every documentary that I've seen, showed it has been a decade that was really struggling, and kind of the American spirit was very low at that time. And then you go into the 80s, and I am a huge Ronald Reagan fan, and I've seen him in person back in the day, and you know, it just seemed like America was alive again, you know, and the space program, and of course the economy booming and everything, and you know, we were proud to be Americans. And so I was telling Steph, I said, it's not necessarily every generation that we get less patriotic. It depends on what we're being fed. Because you look in the 70s, and then the 80s are more patriotic probably than the 70s. Everything I've read says so. And so if it was that other pattern, then you would say, no, it'd be less patriotic. It's what we're being fed today. And what our government is feeding us today, to be more relying on them. And any time that you give all the power to somebody else, and give all the power to the government in this case, then you set yourself up for all kinds of corruption. Because there's all kinds of corruption in our government today. And I realize that there always has been to a certain point, but it's getting worse and worse. And so I think a part of what we need to realize, especially in holidays like this, is where this great country that we live, where this came from. You know, what has given us this freedom? Yes, it has come from God Almighty ultimately, but also over the years it's come from brave patriots who, armed with really nothing much more than like rifles, hunting rifles and things of that nature, stood up against the most powerful nation of that time. You know, I think it was 2 weeks ago, Father's Day, that I quoted or read to you something about Paul Harvey. I love Paul Harvey, okay? The late Paul Harvey, the greatest personality, radio personality, I think, that's ever lived. And so I'm on a Harvey kick, all right? So I've got something else I want to read to you, and it's lengthy. Please don't fall asleep. Y'all still with me this morning? Isn't it nice to be able to be in a nice air conditioning room like this when it's 150 outside? But let's stay awake. Let's praise God. Let's look at the scriptures together. So this is from Paul Harvey. This goes all the way back to July the 4th, 1974. And he's talking about the patriotism of our founding fathers and the signers of the Declaration of Independence, and how that is a lesson in the cost of liberty. And so he goes into great detail talking about those signers of the Declaration. And I can't read all of this to you because it's just too long, but I'm going to read a big portion to you. He says, of the 56 signers of the Declaration, few were long to survive. Five were captured by the British and tortured before they died. 12 had their homes from Rhode Island to Charleston sacked and looted, occupied by the enemy, or burned. 2 of them lost their sons in the army. 1 had 2 sons captured. 9 of the 56 died in the war from its hardships or from its more merciful bullets. Harvey wrote, I don't know what impression you had of these men who met that hot summer in Philadelphia, but I think it's important this July 4th that we remember this about them. They were not poor men. They were not wild-eyed pirates. They were men of means. They were rich men, most of them, who enjoyed much ease and luxury in personal living. Not hungry men, but prosperous men. Wealthy landowners, substantially secure in their properties. But they considered liberty. This is much as I shall say of it. They had learned that liberty is so much more important than security. Amen. Amen to that. Liberty is so much more important than security, that they pledged their lives, their fortunes, and their sacred honor, and they fulfilled their pledge, they paid the price, and freedom was born. So then Harvey goes on and details some of these that broke away from, of course, British rule and succeeded, and of course forming a more excellent government that is by the people and for the people, so that we can have human rights and equality and freedom and liberty like our God, our Creator, meant for it to be. And so let me read a few of these. I can't read all of them, but the signer, Carter Braxton of Virginia, lost his property and fortune and said he died in rags. All of these men very wealthy, and they gave up this for liberty and for our country. Thomas McKean of Delaware was so harassed by the enemy that he was forced to move his family 5 times in 5 months. He served in Congress without pay, his family in poverty and in hiding. Wow. John Hart was from New Jersey. He was a farmer. And he was driven from his wife's bedside while she was dying. Their 13 children fled in all directions for their lives. Harvey wrote, his fields and gristmill were laid waste. For more than a year, he lived in forests and caves and returned home after the war to find his wife dead, his children gone, and his properties gone. He died a few weeks later of exhaustion and a broken heart. It's just baffling as you continue to read about our founding fathers and the signers of the Declaration of Independence, knowing what they gave up, knowing what they sacrificed to have what we so often take for granted. God forbid us and forgive us for doing that. May we repent if we do that. May we always think about the price that has been paid so that we can have the freedom that we have today. And we know why they did it. They did it because of liberty. They did it for freedom. And, of course, so everybody can have equal rights. But have you ever wondered how, you know? Have you ever wondered how? Have you ever read about all the different battles and how you have all of these different guys with, like I said, nothing more than hunting rifles and shotguns going up against the most powerful army in the world? How in the world? You remember back weeks ago and a couple months ago, we talked about David's mighty men of valor? Man, I love that passage in Samuel. And how were they able to do that? It was because of God, right? Oh, that doesn't take away from their valor. That doesn't take away from how brave they were. It doesn't take away from all the different skills maybe that they had. But they won because of God. That's the number one reason. And so you think, how in the world could these guys go up against the most powerful army of the world at that time? Well, it's the same reason. Listen, this is the last line in the Declaration of Independence. It says, and for the support of this declaration, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor. Amen. The providence of God, the power of God, the forbearance of God. Isn't that awesome? That's why we have what we have today. Liberty, freedom, the rights that we have, they weren't cheap. They weren't free. And so the Declaration of Independence, those who signed that, did so at a great cost. Every single one of them did. And also the freedom that we continue to enjoy to this day, we have at a great cost, right? Listen to this. The U.S. has suffered almost 3 million casualties of war, with around 1,357,000 in deaths. Man, that's a lot of people. And there's probably not a person here today that doesn't touch in one way or another, whether it's a spouse or a child, oftentimes a child, a grandchild, a friend, a co-worker. It touches every single one of us. You know, I realize that we're unhappy in a lot of ways with our country, right? We are. I mean, we live in changing times, and we would rather complain about our country than take pride in our country today. may we repent of that. I know there's a lot going on that we dislike. I know that we're not happy overall with our congressman, with our president maybe, with some things that are going on and some laws that are being passed that are not righteous, they're not godly. I realize that, but we still live in the greatest country in the world, the greatest nation in the world. And as I said before, the American dream is still alive. That's why people are still trying to come in droves, because this is a great country. And it's great when we realize that it's great, when we're willing to sacrifice for it, and when we realize that it's from God. He's the one that blesses us. And so we're about to sing three songs, and Daniel is going to lead us in those songs. And I want us just simply to think about how blessed we are. You know, these are patriotic songs. And I've talked to some people that, well, is that appropriate in worship? Yes, absolutely it is. You know, singing is to praise God and worship God, but it's also to teach and encourage one another. These songs that we're about to sing, they are patriotic. They're thanking God for our country, for our nation, and also asking God's help and guidance and protection as well. And so, yes, they are faith-based. And they should get us to thinking about how blessed we are and asking God to continue to bless us in our nation. Daniel.
First is number 803, first and last, 803.
My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim's pride, from every mountainside, let freedom ring. Our fathers, God, to thee, author of liberty, to thee we sing. Long may our land be bright with freedom's holy light. Protect us by thy might, great God, our King.
Number 801, 801, first and last.
Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountain majesty, above the fruited plain. America, America, God shed his grace on thee, and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. Oh, beautiful for patriot dream that sees beyond the years, thine alabaster cities gleam undimmed by human tears. America, America, God shed his grace on thee, and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea.
Number 802.
Mm-hmm. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He had loosed the faithful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. In the beauty of the lilies, Christ was born across the sea, with the glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us live to make men free, while God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Our God is marching on.
Amen. Thank you, Daniel. Y'all remember this quote? President Kennedy, ask not what your country can do for you, but ask what you can do for your country. I wish that was more of the mentality today. I really, really do. You know, in turbulent times back in that time, before I was even born, dealing with Vietnam, actually we weren't actually involved in the war at that time, but it was going on and had been going on. And so we were feeling the effects of that. And of course, there was a lot of uneasiness and maybe some mentality having to do with what our country can do for us. And so he was challenging the generation of that day to not just think about yourself and what you can get from your country, but rather how great your country is and what you could do for your country. And I wish, like everything, that we have that mentality today. May we have that mindset. That is a Christian mindset. Selflessness. It's not about me, it's about others, you know. What programs can I be on? What assistance can I be on? I realize sometimes that's needed, but in what way? This mentality of everybody owes me, and I can't stand that, and we see so much of that today. Entitlements. I'm entitled to this, and you owe me that because you're my parent or because you are my country, and so you give these things to me. No, that's not how it should be. We're of the people and for the people, right? It should be, what can I do? Let me stand on my own two feet. Let me pull myself up by my own bootstraps. You know, let God guides me and he directs me and he helps me and he blesses me, but he expects me to do something, not to just sit and wait for a handout. What can I do for my country? May we adopt that way of thinking today. May we instill that with our children and with our grandchildren, because that's something that our government, I believe, is trying to take away from us as socialism is coming in more and more, which eventually always, always leads to what? Yes, communism. Anytime, as I said before, that you give so much power to the government, there's always going to be greed, there's always going to be corruption, and because of that, there's all kinds of oppression and problems. But when we stand on our own two feet, realizing that God is the one that gives us all things, then we can succeed, and that's how this nation was born. You know, what can we do? What can we do? What can I do for this nation? Think of a couple of things. First of all, pray, right? Pray, be prayerful. 1 Timothy 2:1-4 talks about praying for those who are in authority that we may live a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness. And so we need to be praying that we can live that kind of life, the life that we've been so blessed to be able to live, that we can live godly, that we can live our faith out as we should be able to without being oppressed. May we continue to do that and pray for that and pray for our leaders. But it's a little bit more than just prayer, is it not? Why don't we take upon ourselves to do something? I love this handwritten prayer by George Washington. This actually goes back to 1752, and there's seven personal pronouns. And notice there, he says, open my eyes, not talking about others, help me, examine myself concerning my knowledge, increase my faith, direct me, all having to do with help me, God. You know, let's stop complaining about our country because of the direction that we're going. What, you know, Jesus says, what can you add to your stature by worrying, right? Nothing, right? What do we help in any kind of way by just sitting around and belly aching about the direction of our country? But may we try our best to do what we can do to bless our country by living out our faith and helping others out. Amen? That's it begins, yes. Get out and vote. It's kind of like, you know, what can I do? Belly aching about the country, about our president, and we don't even get out and vote, right? Do what you can do. You vote, and you also live out your faith in your life, and that will bless other people. It will bless our nation as a whole. But it starts with me. It starts with me being a child of God, but it also continues with me living that out in my life each and every day, in my attitude, in my actions, in the way that I treat other people, in every relationship, in my responsibility to work and carry my own load, in every aspect. That is God's way. That is the Christian way, and that is actually America's way from the very beginning. This morning, if you have a need to obey the gospel of Jesus Christ, to put the Lord on in baptism, to commit yourself to Him, you'll be so very blessed by giving your life to Jesus Christ. If you need to do that, we want to encourage you to do that. Maybe you just simply need to repent of sin in your life, to cease from doing that, to turn and go a different direction, to be more faithful to God and more faithful to your brethren. And if we can pray for you or help you in any way whatsoever, let's sing a song to encourage us all.
I'll
Sister Jean Bond has come forward, matriarch of the family here, and I thank the world of her. And I told her she was sharing with me that she feels like she has done a lot wrong in her life, and that's bothering her greatly right now, and she needs to be forgiven for that, and she wants to be forgiven for that. And I think that she has been forgiven for that, but she wants the prayers of the church, and that just shows a tender heart, does it not? I told her, I said, you know, you're one of the greatest examples of a Christian I've ever seen. And to have her come forward and say that she wants to be forgiven of sin in her life, that's what it's all about. Godly sorrow produces repentance leading to salvation. To feel bad about sin that I've committed because that's against a righteous and holy God that loves me so very much that I'm willing to turn from that and make that right. We love you, sister. We love you so very much. And we're going to pray for you as a congregation, as a church family at this time. I'm going to ask Brother Henry, as one of our elders, to do that. Brother Henry.
Father, thank you again for the privilege of being here. We've had a good service, Father, and it topped off with one of our elderly ladies coming forward. We pray, Father, that you would be with Sister Jean. We know I've known her ever since I've been coming here, better than 60 years, Father, and I've always respected her as a kind and loving person, Father. And I know that times we do things contrary to your will, Father, and we are all sorry for that. Apostle Paul was, even the terrible sinner that he was, God forgave him, but he could never forget it. And Father, the problem that we have remembering things, Father, may it always help us to do better in our lives. And Father, we pray for Jean, help her to be willing that God has forgiven her of her sins. But Father, we pray at the same time, Father, that your will be done in all things regarding her. And Father, bless her and help her to have a pure heart. Help us all to have pure hearts, Father, and give her comfort in her last days with us. We hope that she has many days left, but Father, at the same time, we know as we grow older, our body begins to deteriorate, and sooner or later we depart this life to come and be with you. And Father, we have no doubt that will be her reward when this life is over. Give us of our sins, and your will be done in all things. For in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Mama Stewart, I remember when we were growing up, you were the most kind and generous person I believe I've ever met. I used to go over to your house and eat many meals. And I just love you to death. But bow with me, please. Our dear and gracious Heavenly Father, we know that today as we come to church and worship unto you, and Father, we know in our hearts that for all that we have and the reason that we're here and the reason that we live in a free country to come unto you is because of the gift that you have given us, your Son. And Father, we thank you for letting us live in this country that we know is freedom to come and worship unto you without persecution, without cause. Father, we thank you for being our almighty God and Father. Father, we pray that Mark said this morning to never let us take for granted our freedom or anything that you give us. And Father, if we ever do, please forgive us and put us on the right track. Father, we thank you for our church. We thank you for our members. We thank you, Father, for those that minister to the church, the elders, deacons, song leaders, Sunday school teachers, and Mark and his family. And we thank you, Father, for all that participate in our security. And Father, as we remember these things and our freedom, we thank you for all those that have fallen and those that give us our freedom, our military, first responders, doctors and nurses, firefighters, rescue workers, police, and security people. Father, we thank you for the many blessings that you store upon us, for there are so many that we can't name and we will try to never take for granted for what you give us. Father, we ask that you help us to grow so that we can have that home with thee in heaven. We thank you, Father, for all things, for our health, our loved ones, and especially, Father, be with those that are on our prayer list, sick list, shut-in, nursing homes, hospital and disease, and afflicted little children, and be with our elderly in their golden years and the youth that are growing up in this troublesome world. And Father, we pray for this world that's turned their back on you, that they'll come to their senses and come into you. And we pray for those that are lost, Father. We pray for those that are putting their lives back together for tornadoes and floods, fires, earthquakes, and all disasters in their lives. And Father, we thank you for this day that you have given us to come into you. And we thank you, Father, for your Son that was sacrificed on the cross. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to study your word and sing songs of praise unto you. Thank you for everything, Father. Go with us, Father, today and watch over us and protect us. And please, Father, put it on our hearts to come back tonight and worship unto you at your house. In Jesus' name we pray, Father. Amen.